good afternoon. Thank you for joining us for our webinar today with Dorsie Boddiford Kuni. We're going to be talking today about solo 401ks, and Dorsie is going to give us the reasons that solo 401ks are very important to sole proprietors and independent business owners. They're great accounts. So hang in there with us as we talk about this, and we will be taking questions. So my name is Larissa. I'm with Advanta IRA, and we are a self-directed IRA administrator. And basically that means that we can help you with things like solo 401k accounts and investing in alternative assets. So we do a lot of education here at Advanta. We talk a lot about what it is that you can do for yourself in saving for retirement. So we're happy to have you join us today. We will be taking questions during the webinar. So if you have any questions, go ahead and make sure to type them into the chat box. We are going to keep all attendees on mute, but we'd be happy to take your questions. So as we go through, just type them in there and we'll stop and answer your questions. And we'll also set aside some time for questions at the end. I had a question here. Can we download the slides? If you'd like the slides, go ahead and email me and I will make sure to get them out to you. And this presentation is also being recorded, so you'll have a chance to listen again if you'd like, and it'll be sent out to all attendees. It'll also be placed on our YouTube channel. So before I introduce Dorsie, I'm going to give you some information about Advanta IRA, who we are, what we do. We are a third-party administrator for self-directed retirement accounts. I'll talk in just a second about the different accounts before we talk specifically about solo 401ks. But we've been doing self-directed retirement accounts and a few other types of accounts for about 15 years now. We have two offices. We're located in the Tampa Bay area of Florida. We're also in Atlanta, Georgia. But we can help anybody anywhere. So we have clients nationwide and even worldwide. We have clients invested nationwide and even outside of the U.S. So really the investment options are just about limitless. You just want to keep in mind that there are some rules when you're self-directing your accounts. And I know Dorsie is going to go over them a little bit in this webinar, but if you're interested in learning more about the rules and types of investments, join us for any number of upcoming webinars and seminars we have, as well as, join us, check out our YouTube channel, where we archive all of our events. So here's just a couple of different places you can check out to read about investments, rules, and different strategies that we see. AdvantaIRA.com, of course. You'll find our events at AdvantaIRA.com/events. You can find us on demand and then also check out our blog where we share a lot of information. Something that we don't do is give investment, tax, or legal advice. So, if you ask us about the rules, hey, can we do this? Can I do that? Is this investment structure okay? We're going to tell you, we're going to give you information on the rules. We're going to do the very best we can to educate you on IRC 4975, how the investment strategy you're looking at pertains to the rules, but ultimately you want to talk to an attorney or your CPA and make sure that that investment is something that you're comfortable with in your retirement account. And just keep in mind that, if you don't have a professional that you can go to, we can always refer you to professionals who we know work with self-directed IRAs. And if you're not sure if your question falls within the, whether or not something you're allowed to do, just go ahead and ask it anyway. And we'll either, yes, this is something you can do, no, you can't, or I'll refer you out to a professional that can help you. So again, we're going to talk specifically today about solo 401ks and the benefits to those types of accounts. And Dorsie's also going to talk to you about an upcoming three-part webinar she has that you can join her for. But I also want to give everybody on the webinar, anybody that's listening to the recording, an idea of the other types of accounts that can be self-directed. So, of course, the most common accounts that we see are going to be traditional IRAs and Roth IRAs. And of course, those accounts are great. They're a great way to save for retirement, and they each have their own benefit. But as a sole proprietor or an independent business owner, there are other types of accounts out there available to you as well that you may be able to use along with traditional and Roth IRAs when you're saving for retirement and investing in alternatives. So when you're doing that, just keep in mind that any of these types of accounts may work for you, but you always want to check in with your CPA and make sure that you're getting the account that's the one that will benefit you the most. But for sole proprietors, of course, the individual 401k, but there's also simple IRAs, SEP IRAs, and they all have, something that may benefit you in your business model. We also can help you with education savings accounts and health savings accounts, because the rules for self-directing those are going to be exactly the same. And so we can hold those accounts for you here at Advanta. There are so many different investments that we see on a daily basis here at Advanta. And so there's some very unique investments, and then something that I would consider something we see every day. So lending money, for example, that's something we see here at Advanta every day. Lending money in the form of a note and mortgage, having it secured by real estate, being the bank, as we like to say, and determining, you know, basically the rate at which your retirement account will grow. So when you lend out money, that's a great way to say, okay, I'm not going to take anything less than 8% or 10% or maybe even as high as 15%, depending on the terms that you agree to with your borrower. We also see a lot of real estate here, but, you know, less common investments are going to be things like option contracts, lease options, foreign currency exchange, gold and silver bars. Today, we had somebody call us about investing in livestock, so cattle and hogs. All of those things are permitted within a self-directed IRA or retirement plan. You just want to be aware of the rules. And again, Dorsie's going to touch on those, but if you're interested in learning more, join us for other webinars that we have. So I'm going to introduce now Dorsie Boddiford Kuni. She's going to join us and give us the information, you know, why she likes the solo 401k, what the advantages that she finds to that type of account are, and she's going to also answer your questions. How are you doing today, Dorsie?
Hi, Larissa. Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Absolutely.
Yes. So I'm Dorsie Boddiford Kuni. I am a full-time real estate investor in the Atlanta area. And I have a ways to go until my retirement, but because I am self-employed, you know, I feel that responsibility on myself to make sure that my family and myself, we're set up for when I do retire, when I am able to be completely financially free. So in looking at how I wanted to invest for retirement, I was, of course, looking at the IRAs, and then I came across the solo 401k about 6 or 8 years ago and started researching it. And today I want to talk to you all about some of the attractive benefits of why I like using my solo 401k really aggressively. And then also, you know, some of the other plans that I can use alongside, you know, contribute to as well as with the solo 401k. So today, let me see if I can, There we go. So I'm going to show you the 10 reasons. We're going to discuss 10 reasons why I choose to use the solo 401k for my retirement investments. So number one, the profit in my solo 401k, it's completely tax-free. So completely tax-free interest, earnings within that solo 401k account. So what do I mean by that? Well, the solo 401k plan that I have, it has a traditional component and there's also a Roth component. So I've elected to have a Roth component within my solo 401k plan. And what that means is when I contribute to my traditional component, that money goes in tax-free. So if I contribute, if my company contributes, that money goes in tax-free. It's invested, it grows. And then when I reach the age of retirement, when I want to start withdrawing those funds from my 401k, that's when the tax gets hit. So that contribution and the growth is taxed at the age of retirement or at the time of required minimum distributions when I'm older. Now, the Roth component, and this is the part of my solo 401k that I really like, I put that money in after tax. So I'm paying the taxes on that contribution. So it might not be as big as what I could do for the traditional, but then all that money grows completely tax-free within that Roth component of the solo 401k. So when I do withdraw that money, when I do distribute out that money from my solo 401k, I'm completely tax-free. So what I'm thinking is I have a good 30, 40 years before I'm gonna touch this money. So for me, I wanna go ahead and pay the taxes up front. Because I don't know, I'm thinking down the road, taxes are probably going to increase. I just don't have to worry about it. So in your situation, though, you might decide, okay, the traditional, I'd rather go ahead and put it in tax-free and pay taxes later. You know, you just kind of have to see what works best for you. But for me, that Roth component of the solo 401k is awesome. And that's one of the main reasons why I like the solo 401k. So number two, any prohibited transactions in my solar 401k, they're only penalized 15%. So Larissa, you talked a few minutes ago about how there are those rules you have to worry about when you self-direct your investments. And you know, not that I would ever do anything wrong, right? But you know, we still have to worry about these rules, and that's that IRC 4975. But I just want to touch on it real quick. The first thing to think about with those prohibited transactions are there are disqualified parties. So that means there are people that you cannot invest with because of the rules that the IRS said, okay, these retirement accounts, these tax advantage, advantageous retirement accounts, you know, we have to have a level playing field here. So we have to make sure that, you know, that you are not trying to benefit from your own retirement too soon. So disqualified parties. First of all, yourself. So my solo 401k can't invest in myself. My solo 401k can't invest in my spouse, my parents, my grandparents, any children's spouses. So basically those lineal ancestors and lineal descendants. Also any fiduciary to your solo 401k. Anyone providing services to your solo 401k, including any employees or relatives of that person providing the service, and then also your solo 401k administrator or plan provider. But like the litmus test, kind of my rule of thumb with, you know, who is disqualified, for me, it's anyone who, through investing your solo 401k, with whom it could appear that you yourself might have received a direct or indirect benefit from. So like my sister, you know, I might be able to invest with her. It's not prohibited, but like it could show that I'm receiving an indirect benefit from, or a direct benefit, because I've invested with her. I'm helping her out. She's family. You know, maybe it's helping my parents out that I'm helping her out. So I just really like to keep everything arm's length, and I try to stay far, far away from these prohibited transaction rules. But you can see here how, you know, sometimes we might be walking a fine line. Again, prohibited transactions could be in prohibited investments. So like art, a collectible, an antique, you know, vintage wine or something. That's pretty easy to stay away from those prohibited investments, but we are walking a fine line sometimes when we're self-directing our retirement accounts. So what does that mean for the solo 401k though? Well, if you're investing with a solo 401k, you're only penalized. So if you're investing your IRA and you do a prohibited transaction, then that whole IRA could be deemed distributable. So what that means, okay, let's say you have like $1 million IRA, and you do a little $10,000 investment. Well, if that investment was a prohibited transaction, then that whole IRA, it can be blown up as of the day that that investment is done. So, you know, little $10,000, even though it's $1 million IRA, all of that money is deemed distributed as of the day of that investment, and you could lose that whole IRA. So that's a really big deal. But with the solo 401k, you do, you know, $1 million solo 401k, that little $10,000 no-no investment, that's only going to be penalized 15%. So we're talking, what, like $1,500? And that $1 million IRA, or $1 million solo 401k, rather, is still intact, is still in place. As long as you undo that prohibited transaction, you pay the penalty, you're okay. It's really just a slap on the wrist versus the IRA. So again, that is a huge benefit because I'm self-directing, I'm doing my own investments. So, you know, if something were to happen, I realize the penalties are much less strict than if I were to do the same investment prohibited transaction within my IRA. Number three, I can sign as trustee for my solo 401k and have full checkbook control. So I am a full-time real estate investor, so I like to invest my solo 401k in real estate investments as well. So when I come across a deal that I'm thinking, ooh, this would be really good for my solo 401k, all it is I can pull out my checkbook from my desk and from my solo 401k, and I can sign it as the trustee for the solo 401k, and I can fund the deal right then and right there. At my local bank, I have my personal checking account. I got my personal savings account. I have my business account. They know me at my local bank, and I like doing business with them. It makes things a lot easier. Well, they also have my solo 401k account there too. So you can see how that control can really help you invest in more opportunities. You're not having to go through the forms and direct a custodian or another person. If you have it, your 401k set up to where you own your own plan trustee, then you can be signing those documents and doing those investments yourself. You know, some people say, oh, well, I can have an IRA, own an LLC and blah, blah, blah. Well, with the solo 401k, you can have it set up from day one, have it in your plan that you can have control as the trustee. So I see that as a huge benefit. It really helps me because sometimes, you know, I'm not as eager to be thinking about my retirement plan because, you know, some of that it's like, okay, I've got, you know, so many years, but then again, you know, it really is important to keep that money working. So when I can make a split second decision to start investing that money in a deal, for me, that is very important. And that is, a huge, huge sense of control that I can be able to do that as easily as it is. Number four, I can do my own bookkeeping and my own tax reporting for my solo 401k. So like I said, I have my solo 401k set up to where I am my own plan trustee, but I'm also my own plan administrator. So I am doing all my own bookkeeping. I'm doing all my own tax reporting, and it just all kind of goes hand in hand with my day-to-day business. So like I use Quicken. I know some people use QuickBooks. I just have like a separate account for my solo 401k, and I just kind of keep track of everything there. I have, you know, my notebooks for my solo 401k, keep track of all the tax reporting and everything else that I'm doing in my solo 401k. So with the tax reporting, I personally think it's pretty easy. It's form 5500 easy. So, okay, easy. But it really, there's like four or five lines that you actually have to fill out. And it's two pages, and you don't have to report if you are under $250,000 in assets in your solo 401k. You're not required to report. You might decide that you want to go ahead and report for different reasons, and I usually do, no matter what, just so that I have reported to the IRS for certain reasons. But it's pretty easy to do it all in-house. Number five, I can make higher contributions. And I was talking to some friends yesterday about this webinar, and they're like, oh, I think the contributions are, you know, the number one advantage of the solo 401k. And many people think that too, because with the higher contributions compared to an IRA, I mean, it's crazy large compared to the IRA. So with a solo 401k, in 2019, you can contribute up to a total of $56,000. And then there's a catch-up contribution. If you're age 50 or older, you have $6,000 extra that you can contribute as well. Now, with an IRA, though, you can only, in 2019, you can only contribute up to a total of $6,000 and then $7,000 if you're age 50 or older. So for both the traditional and Roth, there's that combined contribution of $6,000. So you can see here how, you know, that's so much more than just a small little IRA contribution. And the other thing is you can contribute to your solo 401k and you can contribute to your IRA as well in the same year. So it's just, to me, it's a no-brainer. As a self-employed individual, it's a no-brainer to have this solo 401k account as well as my IRA. So let's talk a little bit more about contribution limits. You can contribute up to a total of $56,000, like we just said. So you yourself can contribute up to $19,000. And then there's that $6,000 contribution if you're age 50 or older. And then your company can contribute 20 to 25% of your profit into your solo 401k up to the combined total maximum contribution. So depending on, you know, if you're a S corporation or LLC, it's 25% of compensation as defined by the plan, or 20% of compensation for self-employed Schedule C individuals. And there's actually a calculation, but it comes out to right about 20%. So you're making contributions and your company can make contributions up to that combined total of 56 or 52,000. And again, this is what my solo 401k plan looks like. I've got the traditional component, and then I have the Roth component. So in the traditional component, that's where my employer contributions are made. That's where my company makes the before tax contribution. I myself can decide if I want to do a before tax contribution as well. And again, that investment grows tax deferred and it will later be taxed on distribution. But then in the Roth component, that's only for employee deferrals. So that $19,000 can go into the after tax Roth. It grows tax free and there is no tax later on the distribution. Number six, I can contribute no matter how much income I make. So with a Roth IRA, Roth IRA contributions are limited once I have an adjusted gross income of 122, or I'm married, so it's $193,000. But you don't even have to worry about that with the traditional solo 401k and the Roth component of the solo 401k. I can contribute no matter what my income is. And then also, you know, for the traditional IRA, there is no income restriction, but there are limits on deductibility. So, you know, there's some backdoor ways of getting around things, but with the solo 401k, there is no income restriction. Number seven, I can roll over other accounts into my solo 401k. So a little thing, a little quick about rollovers. I can roll over another employer's 401k into a solo 401k. So if I had, you know, a previous employer, I worked for a company and I had a 401k with that company, for whatever reason, I stopped working for that company, I very well may be able to roll that 401k into my solo. So I talk to a lot of people who do this, a lot of self-employed individuals who had that employer they had been with before, and you know, they're able to roll that 401k into their solo 401k so that when they opened up their solo 401k, it was a much larger than, you know, what they could have otherwise have contributed. I can roll over a traditional IRA into a solo 401k. I can also roll over a solo 401k Roth account into another 401k or similar designated Roth account or a Roth IRA. I cannot roll over a Roth IRA into a solo 401k or solo 401k Roth account, and I cannot roll over a solo 401k Roth account into a traditional IRA. There are some other rollovers and conversions that can happen. You might be able to roll over your SEP or your simple IRA into a solo 401k. A lot of times it's going to be based on like what your plan allows and what your plan provider is able to help you with. But you know, you might want to look into these if this looks like it might be of interest to you and you might be able to benefit from it. However, like I said earlier, you know, there's no reason why you can't have some multiple of these accounts. So for me, I have my solo 401k plan, but I also have a traditional and a Roth IRA, and I'm able to make contributions to all of those within the given year, you know, up to the contribution limits. I also have an HSA. So those plans that that Larissa talked about earlier, you know, you might, if you don't have one of these, you know, you might want to look into seeing how you might be able to add that as part of your investment portfolio and working your way towards a very successful retirement.
And Dorsie, no. Before you go on, we did have a few questions.
Okay.
One of the questions was, do you need to close your solo 401k when you're no longer self-employed?
When you know, so with the solo 401k, you need to have a business that is an active live business. So you would either, you know, if you're not having that active business, I guess, Larissa, what would you say with your plan documents? What would you tell your clients?
So as a matter of fact, I think at the self-directed class at the beginning of this month, John Heyer, who is an attorney and works a lot with self-directed IRAs, I think he mentioned something like he believes the IRS at some point would think that you would close the 401k down and either roll it to a traditional IRA or a Roth IRA, depending on the tax status. But the amount of time that you should do that in, he just didn't know. And so I would definitely agree with that statement. But I would say if you're no longer self-employed, you obviously can no longer contribute to that plan. And at some point, you should close the plan down and make those rollovers happen. And of course, if you're no longer self-directing, you can always roll it over into your new employer plan if you're, you know, employed by someone else and they offer that option to you.
Right, exactly. And that's a good point, Larissa. I'm kind of trying to do an overview here, so I wasn't able to go into all the details, but you're absolutely correct. You have got to have active earned income in order to make a contribution. So if you don't have any income, if your company did not turn a profit in a given year, then you don't have to make a contribution. You can choose whether or not you want to make a contribution to your solo 401k, but I would not let that solo 401k sit idle if that company is no longer active. You know, there might be ways that you can kind of make that company stay active so you can have your solo 401k active if you see that as a benefit. But certainly you might want to consider rolling that over before too long, you know, putting it into another type of plan. And again, those rollovers and conversions that we just talked about, you know, there are some solutions to being able to move that solo 401k when the time does come. So good question.
And that's another, and there's another good point to that as well, because just because you are not full-time self-employed, so for instance, I'm an employee of Advanta IRA. I have W-2 income. I have a 9-to-5. But if you also have earned income outside of that 9-to-5, you may qualify for the solo 401k. And even if you're actively participating in your company's 401k or employer plan, you still may be eligible to make contributions to a solo 401k based on that income as a sole proprietor or independent business owner outside of that W-2. So you still may be eligible. You want to keep that in mind. And what you'll want to do is talk to your CPA, have them help you with those calculations so that you can fully take advantage of contributing on both your W-2, you know, employer's plan, and then also maybe your side gig, so to speak, for that solo 401k. I had another question pop up asking if you can partner with somebody else who has a solo 401k or self-directed IRA in real estate. And the answer is yes, you can partner. Depending on whether or not that person is considered disqualified is going to depend on what that structure looks like. And we talk about that in some of our other webinars, so I don't want to get too in-depth on that. But the answer is yes, you can partner. There's going to be some structuring going on there, and we can talk about that. So if you have questions outside of that, please go ahead and email me or give me a call. Please continue with the questions. We love to get them answered for you. And with that, go ahead, Dorsie.
Okay, thanks. Number 8, moving along. My solo 401k can put a down payment on a house, take out a loan, and not have to pay UBIT on the rent received. So, okay, quick overview on what is UBIT. UBIT is unrelated business income tax. And essentially, it's a tax on your retirement account if your retirement account is investing in an ongoing trade or business. So in the respect of debt financing, in your IRA, you're going to be hit with UBIT if you have any debt financing within your IRA investment. So if your IRA were to put a down payment on the house, take out a loan, it will very likely have to pay UBIT on the rent received, on that income received from that investment, because there is debt financing. However, with the solo 401k, there is no tax on the debt financed income for that purchase or for like any major renovations within an asset in that 401k. So here is an example. Let's say that there is a house that's maybe a $100,000 house. And your solo 401k, let's say it has $20,000 in your solo 401k. Well, your solo 401k can also get a mortgage. So you put down the $20,000 as a down payment. Your solo 401k puts the $20,000 rather, and the solo 401k gets an $80,000 mortgage. Your solo 401k hires a property manager. They put some tenants in place, and the tenants pay $1,000 in rent. So that asset creates $1,000 in rent. And mortgage payments, let's say this is a 30-year mortgage, payments are somewhere around $590 a month. And then for the sake of example, let's say $300 of expenses each month. So we're talking, you know, property manager, talking taxes, insurance, vacancy, maintenance, you know, all the good expenses that go into a rental property. So at the end of the day, each month, your solo 401k gets $110 in cash flow. So not a huge chunk of money, but, you know, over time, that's really going to add up. And also, that's tax-free. So again, like like I said earlier, I like doing investments mostly in my Roth account. I like focusing on that Roth component of the solar 401k. So that $20,000 down payment would have already been taxed when I had contributed to my Roth solar 401k. So that $110 cash flow is going to be coming back tax-free. So what does this investment look like over time? Well, that solar 401k is getting tax-free cash flow for the life of that investment, but also you're getting tenant-paid amortization. So in 30 years, when that mortgage is paid off, that $100,000 house probably not just going to be worth $100,000. We're hoping there's going to be some appreciation over the next 30 years. So you've got all this equity, you've got a free and clear house in your solar 401k, you've got it, you have a free and clear rent coming in, your expenses are down. So that's just an example of one of those kind of deals you can do in your solar 401k. I will say if you do it in your IRA, you know, you probably will have to pay UBIT. You'll likely have to pay UBIT on that cash flow because you have a mortgage within your IRA. With the solar 401k, you don't have to worry about that. Couple of caveats, like, you know, with putting property in your retirement accounts, I'm always very careful about that because there is some liability associated with having an asset in your retirement account, such as property, real property. But also providing a service to your solar 401k. We talked about prohibited transactions and how it would be a prohibited transaction if I provided a service to my own solar 401k. So for me, I personally would not feel comfortable managing that rental property. I'd want to hire somebody else. So that's another added expense. But that UBIT tax that we were talking about, where it would be hit with the IRA, but not with the solar 401k, that UBIT tax a lot of times is a whole lot higher than if I were to be doing this investment personally. So you can see how that's a big advantage of the solar 401k over the IRA. Number nine, I can make a loan from my solar 401k to myself. So you might have heard that you can borrow from your solar 401k, and there are some parameters on that. Loans amounts made from my solar 401k, they cannot exceed 50% of the amount in my 401k or $50,000, whichever is lower. And it must be a reasonable interest rate, at least prime, and terms of 5 years in some cases, like if I were to borrow from my personal residence, it might be repaid in 15 years. And as long as I pay that loan as arranged, it's not considered a distribution. There are a lot of rules to this, and you know, some plans do not allow for you to do this. So you want to make sure you look through your plan documents and see if you have this ability. If you're looking into setting up a solar 401k, you know, these are the kind of questions you want to ask. You know, can I have a Roth component of my solar 401k? Can I borrow from my solar 401k? Because you want to make sure that all of this is in your plan document to allow you to do so when the time comes. But a word of warning. When you make a loan to yourself, if you're going to be making multiple loans to yourself, it's not always that 50% threshold or the $50,000. There is a special calculation for multiple loans. So you have to be very careful and follow those rules carefully, or else it will look like you're distributing to yourself and it might be considered non-qualified distribution. So we're going to be talking about a little bit more in the webinar that John and I are hosting that I'll mention later. But you do have to be very careful of doing these types of loans. A lot of people see this as a huge benefit because if you don't have a lot of investment opportunities coming your way, then it might be a no-brainer for you to borrow from your own solar 401k so that you can be putting that interest back into your solar 401k and getting that money working. For me personally, I see that it's an opportunity cost, right? Like I would rather borrow the money cheaper somewhere else, and I would rather have my solar 401k lend, you know, out to maybe like a higher rate than what I would be charging myself. So, you know, there's some advantages to this. If it sounds like it's good for you, then you might want to look into this little tool. And number 10, last but not least, I can self-direct and invest my solar 401k in notes, real estate, and other investments I know. So Larissa mentioned this right off the bat. It is definitely an important aspect of a solar 401k account that is self-directed. And for me, you know, I'm a full-time real estate investor, so I like dealing with real estate investments. So flip investor loans. My solo 401k makes loans to investors who are purchasing homes, rehabbing, and then reselling them. So flipping the properties. And then also landlords. So investors with rental property, my solo 401k will make longer term loans to those investors, and also wrap loans. So for me, I like this little strategy. It's called a wrap mortgage, and I also teach on it. But, and I think Larissa, we have a past webinar that we did together maybe last year that I think is on the Advanta website. If y'all wanna learn more, you can check that out. But essentially, those wrap loans have helped me when I've had very little money in my retirement accounts, and it's helped me grow those funds aggressively. So that you're working with other investors, your solo 401k is working with other investors, and being able to make huge returns together. So it's been really great. And I, all that being said, you can tell now that I really like holding notes and mortgages in my solo 401k. It's less liability, you know, it's just a piece of paper, but they have great returns. And again, these are, you know, investments that I know and I'm comfortable with. In summary, I am my own trustee, so I'm able to sign the loan documents on behalf of my solo 401k. I can cut those checks. So you can really see how there's a lot more control, and these investments are a whole lot easier to be doing in a solo 401k rather than another vehicle where, there might be a little bit of time or more money involved. So that was the end of my presentation. I know we went through everything kind of quick, but I just wanted to give everyone kind of a taste of some of the attractive benefits of the solo 401k. If you're interested in looking...
We have a bunch of questions, Dorsie, sure. If you want to take those before we wrap up here. So sure. One of the questions is, what is the maximum contribution for the Roth component of this solo 401k? Is it included in the $56,000? And basically, yes, it is included. That $56,000 is going to be a combined total of the employee and employer contribution. The Roth component is going to be $19,000 for 2019 plus the $6,000 catch-up if you're over the age of 50. So you have to have at least that in earned income, and then you can contribute $19,000 or $25,000 over the age of 50, but then that combined total of $56,000 after the employer contribution.
And speaking to that, because earlier you said that, you know, you can have a company, a 401k with a company that you're employed with, and maybe you have a solo 401k for your side hustle. So that Roth contribution, it's per person, right? So that $19,000 mm-hmm. could be for that company contribution and for the, have I just completely confused myself, Larissa? The $19,000 goes over both the personal and that company 401k that you have. However, the company contribution, it is per plan. So, you know, no matter what your employer with your, you know, maybe your large company that you're working for, no matter what they're paying into that 401k, you can still pay into your own solo 401k from your own company. I am sorry, I have just confused everyone. So that $19,000 is per person. So across the board, it's $19,000. But those company contributions can exceed that, certainly.
So if I, you know, for Advanta, if I'm contributing through my company solo 401k, my max amount of $19,000 to my Roth component as the employee, and they're matching some percentage, even though they're matching, I can still go over to my side hustle solo 401k and maximize the employer contribution because it's per plan instead of per person.
Exactly.
Okay, perfect. We had another question on contributions here for you, Dorsie. Does the contribution of my solo 401k have to come from payroll deduction, or can I write a check myself for the employee contribution?
So your employee contribution, for me, I put it into the Roth. So it's an elective deferral. I'm going to be paying taxes on that. So it is going to be coming from my personal checking account. I am going to be paying taxes on that, and it's considered part of what I have made of that company. Did that answer the question?
So another, Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so another question that we had come up is something that I get all the time at Advanta is, do you have to have an annual appraisal of a property owned by your account? And, you know, the way that I approach that is I look at what Advanta would require. And so even when you have checkbook control, you're your own administrator, when you're leasing plan documents and you're just not sure what we would require. And so this is probably kind of a good way to look at it for yourself too, is not that you have an annual appraisal of the property, that could be very expensive, but that you annually update the value. And so what does that look like? Well, what is the fair market value? Do you have a real estate agent that can help you with an analysis of the property in the area, give you an updated value? And then at the time that you might be required to take minimum distributions or have some taxable event in the 401k, that would be the time that you want to have an annual appraisal done, or maybe in the very least every few years. And here at Advanta, we require it every 3 years. But you know, certainly something that is going to show the actual value at that time if there's a taxable event for that year in your solo 401k. Mm-hmm. I had another question pop up here for you, Dorsie. What about expenses related to researching real estate prior to purchasing? How do you handle that in your solo 401k? Is that, you know, a question that you feel comfortable answering? I typically will tell people to get a legal opinion, but I don't feel like you can reimburse yourself for those expenses. So how would you typically handle that?
Yeah, so easy. Well, first of all, there's no expenses when I'm doing that. Because for me, it's just a little bit of time involved in doing my due diligence. So I just am looking at the investment and overseeing that investment, seeing if that's an investment I want my solo 401k to make. So any appraisals or anything like that, I'm not worrying with that. However, yes, I would agree. If you have like a particular way that you're going about analyzing these investments, you might want to get some legal counsel on, you know, whether or not you are providing a service, first of all, and also, you know, how those expenses need to be done. But for me, it's pretty simple because I'm doing everything myself. I'm not required, you know, not paying any money towards that. And if I felt like I needed a someone to inspect to give a third party opinion, you know, I'm not doing that servicing to my solo 401k. I am getting a qualified professional to do that for my solo 401k on behalf of my solo 401k.
Okay, great. That makes a lot of sense. And then we had another question here about the deadline for 2018 contributions. If you set up a solo 401k for 2018, unfortunately, if your solo 401k was not established by December 31st of 2018, you cannot open one at this time and make contributions. If your solo 401k was already established as of December 31st, you would be eligible to make your contributions. Your employee contribution should have really been made in January. That's really kind of the expected deadline for employee contributions, because it really should be, you know, based on your payment for 2018, your paycheck, so to speak, for 2018. But your employer contribution can be made all the way up until tax filing plus extension. So you still have time to do the employer contribution for 2018, but if you don't have it established by the previous year, you wouldn't be able to make those contributions. Now, just a little side note there, you can still contribute and set up a SEP for 2018. So I don't know if that helps you any, but that's something that you can talk to your accountant about for the previous year. And of course, your traditional and Roth IRAs can still be set up for 2018 and contributed all the way up until April 15th. So you have plenty of time to do that. But my one word of advice is don't wait until the last minute, because I have had people call me and say the check is in the mail and the check gets lost. And unless it's post-dated by April 15th, we cannot accept it. So keep that in mind, whether you're making a contribution with us or some other third party. Let me look at the questions. We had a few more here.
And while you're asking, Well, I was going to say, while you're, that word of warning, go ahead and set up your solo 401k before December, because there's really not that much into setting one up. You will probably want to get an EIN number from the IRS, and you might want to open up that bank account. So don't be scrambling at the end of December to try to set one of these up. So, you know, it's never too early to set one up for the year. Wouldn't you agree, Larissa?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, whenever we get up to deadlines, we get very busy. And so, you know, I would just keep that in mind, because not only are we busy, but so is everybody else. And so when you get to the end of the year, when you're looking at your taxes and stuff, you might have other things on your mind. And then, you know, of course, we try to accommodate everybody that we can when you either have an investment deadline or you're trying to make a contribution. But a lot of times those things are going to be out of our hands, like the IRS deadlines for contributions. And so I have had, unfortunately, people miss those deadlines because, you know, they had other things going on. And that's completely understandable. But I just definitely would not wait until the very last minute. A couple other questions that I had were based on valuations. So, for example, when you have something like an LLC or your solo 401k that you're the administrator and trustee of, how do you know what the value is of that? And very simply, for an LLC, the value of that is going to be, you know, any bank account balance, and then based on the assets. So if you have, you know, if you're lending money out of your LLC or your solo 401k, the value of that account is going to be based on the principal value of any notes that you're holding. And so when we request a value for something like an LLC, what we're looking for is a bank statement, and then, you know, the amortization schedules of any notes you have, even if they're interest only. We want to see that you write, hey, interest only on there. And then, you know, it's an unaudited balance sheet, so to speak. This is what the value is, and we update it accordingly. And again, you know, if you reach the age of required minimum distributions, then at that time you're going to have a third party help you get basically a certified analysis of what the value is for that entity, so that that taxable event is accurate for distribution or what have you. And I see a couple other questions here. I do feel like a lot of the questions based on taxes are going to be questions for your CPA. If you have more questions or you want to talk about your specific structure, deal structure, or what have you, just give me a call or send me an email. I'd be happy to help you with that. And I'm going to turn this back over to Dorsie to talk about the webinar she has coming up and some of the books she has written.
Yes, thanks, Larissa. I am doing a virtual class, a webinar, solo 401k webinar with John Heyer. John Heyer is a tax attorney out of Ohio and currently Puerto Rico. And he has gone through tons of audits. He has been to IRS tax court to defend IRAs. He has clients with solo 401ks. He knows the ins and outs of everything, and he's got quite a unique perspective since he does have all of that experience with the IRS. So I'm going to be showing some like more real life examples, case studies of some deals I've done in the day-to-day management of my solo 401k. It's Tuesdays at 8 p.m. starting March 26th. You can sign up today at assets101.com, and also can go to the website and check out John and my father, Dyke Spotiford, and I. We've written The Solo 401k, An Entrepreneur's Guide to a Powerful Pension Plan. It's a little book, little manual with all you need to know about the Solo 401k. You can also find that on Amazon. And if you want to learn more about my wrap loans that I do, especially those wrap loans that I'm doing in my retirement accounts, I have a home study course, Wrapping for Profits. And you can find more information on that as well at the website. And here is my email, dorsieb@gmail.com. If you have any questions or want to give me any feedback on the presentation today, or just want to chat, shoot me an email. And again, I want to thank you, Larissa and Advanta, for having me today to talk about solo 401ks. I hope you all learned a whole lot. And I hope if you have not set up your solo 401k yet, I hope you strongly consider doing that within the next few days. So thanks again, Larissa.
Thank you, Dorsie. We love having you. Anytime you want to come on, we'd love to have you. And I do want to remind, because Dorsie did mention it, I do want to remind you that you can go and find the presentation that we did on wrap loans on our YouTube channel. So go to YouTube, search Advanta IRA. It is saved on there, and she'll kind of preview wrap loans for you. So if you're not familiar, it's a great investment strategy. I do feel like it's a little more advanced, so it would be a really good idea to check out the webinar and check out the course that she does on wrapping for profits, because it's very interesting. And so if you're not familiar, if you know a little bit about it, definitely do some research on that, because that's a great way to get started with any type of self-directed account, really, not just solo 401ks. And like Dorsie said, if you have questions, let us know. And this, again, will be archived on YouTube. You will get a link to the recording if you have registered. And if you want the slides, please do go ahead and email me, lgreene with an E on the end, @advantaira.com. Thanks, Dorsie.
Thank you, Larissa.